Hi, in this video, I'm going to show you how I made redundant network attached storage server. What's more, it cost me only a fraction of the cheapest available on the market. Please note that this video is not a tutorial, but for those who are looking for cheap alternatives to NAS, I hope I can get you inspired. To start off, let's talk about what NAS is. Network attached storage, or NAS, is a proposed built computer used to provide data to the computers over the network. You can think of it as a standalone file server you can save your stuff to. The reasons why NAS is great for my use are: first, I don't want to store the data on my personal computer. If it gets stolen or damaged, the data might be gone. Second, even if I could, I just don't have the space to store the files. Third, I want easy access. Keeping the data on external drives is always a hassle when you need to access it. Fourth, I need to share files with other house members, as I'm mostly keeping family stuff on the server. Fifth, I need some kind of redundancy. I don't want this data to be gone if something bad occurs. So, now you know the reasoning behind having a NAS, but you might ask, just why not to get like a proposed built one? And my answer to that is, NAS prices can escalate quickly. Base systems only, not including hard drives, are pretty expensive for what they really are. To share files, you don't need crazy computing power. Just I thought I can do the same, but much cheaper, and spoilers, I succeeded. But having said that, if you value your time, you'd better be buying a ready-made NAS. It took me a couple of days, not only configuring my NAS, but also doing physical modifications to the computer, like drilling holes or soldering the cables. Judging by how much time I spent and how much consumer NAS can cost, it would probably be cheaper to just buy one. To start off my build, I needed some kind of a computer as a host system. I've decided to use old terminal. What makes them great, Raspberry Pi alternatives, is that they are dirt cheap and can run x86 applications. I've chosen Dell Z90D7 terminal because A. It cost me like 10 bucks with the power supply. It did not include RAM, but I had 4 GB stick laying around. B. It has low power consumption. This is important for something running 24x7. C. It has a dual core CPU. Yes, comparing to Intel Atoms, that is a feature. D. It includes USB 3.0 ports. That will be important later. E. It's passively cooled. F. It has 2 SATA ports. This is a minimum if you want redundancy, but 3 is preferable. Now, the rest of the things I had to buy. Hard drives. I previously stored the files on a single 2.5 1 TB drive, so I just had to buy the second one. Extension cord. I had to buy SATA with power extension cord, as the terminals are designed to run small flash memory PCBs. They even don't have space for mounting any hard drives inside. You might ask, how am I going to mount 2 of them? Well, I said that they don't have space for mounting, not that they would not fit. And this is the part when this solution is starting to be cursed. I decided that the best place to mount the drives would be on the removable panel of the terminal's case. This way, they would clear everything inside and would be far enough from the CPU heatsink. To mount them, I needed to make some holes for the drive screws. I prepared myself a template for drilling holes that can be 3D printed. If you are interested in it, the link is in the description, but you can always go with the old-fashioned way. After drilling the holes and before mounting the drives, there was one necessary thing to do. You see, the inner section of the panel is made of aluminum, and if I would mount the hard drives with PCB-facing metal, the drives would be fried. So, I made a very professional modification to the drives by putting the clear tape onto the PCB. To make it a little bit more cursed, I cut it to size with tiny blade harvested from the shaver. On to the next thing. The motherboard has 2 SATA ports but only single power connector, thus I had to modify the extension cord I bought. I harvested SATA power connector from burnt up power supply and soldered it in parallel. Now, it was a matter of connecting the hard drives and gently closing the case. To be completely honest, it barely fits. There is just enough space on the inside for the hard drives and the cables. Now, when the hardware side is ready, it's time to install an operating system. Generally speaking, you don't want to have an OS installed on the same drive you keep your data on. This is bad for various reasons, but the most important is that disks would degrade too quickly from the constant use. If you were to run non-redundant setup, this would mean loss of both the system and your data. However, if you run OS from the separate drive, even if it fails, your data on the other drives should be left untouched. Also, this makes data disks' lifespan longer, as they should be working only if you want to read or write the data. So, now you might want to ask, how am I gonna run operating system if all my SATA ports are busy? Well, there are few options, like Pixie boot, which most of the terminals should support, but this contradicts the requirements of the NAS being a standalone system. Not to keep you in suspense, I'm running OS from the pendrive, and the OS itself is Puppy Linux. Wait, don't quit the video yet. I swear that there's a reasoning behind this madness. You see, the Puppy Linux is designed to run this way. It's a RAM-based system, which means it loads its contents into the RAM memory to preserve the storage source it's running from. The flash memory is degrading the most when you perform write operations. Choose the Puppy Linux load its contents into the RAM memory. It can do it entirely or load things on the go, but it's writing changes to the drive only on system shutdown. Another important feature of Puppy Linux is that it was designed for the old or just low power hardware. So, it runs on a terminal with no problem. What do you need to know? Puppy Linux was not my first option when I was looking for a RAM-based OS. First, I tried Slacks, but it's made by one man, support is not existent, mailing list is a spam party, and I could not get it to work properly. Puppy, on the other hand, is very much alive. It hasn't got the greatest documentation, but the forum provides sufficient information. One word about the USB performance. I previously talked about USB 3.0 being the feature of my terminal of choice. Well, if you are trying to run full-fledged operating system, it might be. But, since I'm running system from RAM, the only real performance change it makes is on the boot sequence, but it's not like I'm going to do this very often. Now, on to the configuration side. As I previously said, this is not a tutorial, so I'm not going to give you detailed instruction about configuration. I'll give you a list of things that I spent some time on or that were important in the process. First of all, OS installation. Installing Puppy Linux is pretty straightforward. In my case, it's running from live USB, it does not require any additional installation. I just had to make sure that I'm running it from writable file system. On my first try, I was running into issues that the changes I made were not persistent. This was due to the read-only file system I was using. Second important thing is assigning static IP address for the NAS in the network. The best approach to this is to configure it on the DHCP server rather than locally. This feature is probably already present in the most of the routers. My router is managed by my internet provider, so I wrote an email to their technical department. I included MAC address of the network card and the logical IP address I wanted it to have. Next, after the system is running and static IP is assigned, I installed SSH and VNC servers. You see, Puppy Linux was not intended to be managed via command line and is very GUI focused. For example, installing packages from the official repositories is available only from the Puppy Linux Packet Manager. This is a GUI only app. Puppy has a text mode only option to choose at startup, but the previous example makes it pretty useless. This would mean every time you want to install something, you should change boot mode, making it more cursed than it already is. You generally would want to save the resources, but since this is a proposed build computer, it doesn't really make a difference. back to installing VNC and SSH. You should want to do that to be able to manage your device remotely. I, for example, keep it in the basement, and the only cables that are plugged into it are the Ethernet cable and the power supply. As I previously said, Puppy Linux does not have SSH or VNC installed by default, as the most of the other distros do, so it takes a little bit more time to set up them. Quick tip, VNC works fine with Puppy Linux default user called Spot. Next thing, redundancy. I am running a software RAID 1 setup with MDEDM. This means I have mirroring on my hard drives. They both store exact same information, so if any of them goes bad, I still have a copy left to rebuild from. Remember, RAID is not an alternative to backup. If you care about your data, you should backup it regularly. I'm doing this with use of the external hard drive that is twice the size of the disks inside the machine. This means I can have at least two backups of my data. In terms of configuring RAID 1 with MDEDM, it is straightforward. The only thing non-standard in my case is that I had data already present on one of my disks, so the setup slightly differed. MDEDM also needs to be installed from the Puppy Linux Packet Manager. Another thing worth mentioning is that the auto-mounting deRAID array with fstab does not work. I suspect it might be because MDEDM is started later than the drives are mounted. The workaround to this are Puppy's special scripts that are run at certain times of the boot sequence. I added a script to mount the array after graphical session is started. Last and the most important thing is configuring Samba. If you don't know, Samba is a service that will allow you to share the files on your network. Puppy has Samba installed out of the box. Configuration is a matter of specifying a path where your RAID array is mounted. Thing worth considering, and something that I've done, is creating additional user accounts to access the data for security reasons. These accounts should have only permission to write and modify the files on your share. If credentials to these accounts get leaked, hackers won't have access to making changes on the machine itself and further penetrating your network. For the same reason, you should also change passwords for the default users present in Puppy Linux. Puppy Linux isn't security focused. The biggest downside of it is if somebody gets a physical access to the device, you are in danger, as there are zero to none mechanisms to stop them, because Puppy Linux operates on root account by default. However, you can always protect yourself against the theft with encrypting the data drives. And that's it, fully operational, remotely configured Puppy's NAS. It can always be taken further by installing services for web browser-based configuration or data access, but at its current state, it is sufficient for me. The whole setup cost me 344 zloty, which is about $77, from which 53 zloty was the cost of the terminal with power supply and extension cable. I also calculated the cost of running the server. The average price for 1 kWh in Poland in January 2023 is about 1 zloty, which is around 23 cents. The PC has 65 watt power supply, which means if I would run the PC full blast all day for a month, I would spend around 50 zloty, which is about $11. In reality, it costs less than half of the price, as the server is on idle most of the time. In terms of speeds that I'm getting, I am pleasantly surprised. I measured the speeds about 8 meters from the router on my M1 MacBook Air. Read speeds stay mostly above 60 megabytes per second, reaching near 70s, while write speeds hover around 30. Yes, I am aware that this is not most scientific test. The thing is, I'm happy with the results, and for what I paid for it, it was totally worth it. So, that's the end of this video. Leave a like if you enjoyed it or dislike if you didn't, and subscribe if you want to see more computer or technology related content. Thanks for watching.